I have been involved with Postgres for about 12 years on the business side, on the executive side. Along with Jim, I co-founded EnterpriseDB and a couple of other people. And now I'm on the West Coast, so I'm happy to be getting involved in this a little bit more in the community, on the community side. Thank you, Josh, for helping me do that. And thanks to Rackspace. I want everybody to know that Rackspace contributed the room and the food and the beer at no cost to us, so thank you to Rackspace. We're gonna do a few things tonight. We're gonna start off with Richard Troy, who will give us a, we'll be doing two lightning talks. One will be a, what do you call it when you look back?
Retrospective
on Postgres, a 3-minute or 5-minute retrospective on Postgres and its roots. And then Adrian is gonna come up and talk about a framework, I believe, for API development. And then we will turn it over to Josh Berkus, who will do some announcements and give us a basic update, while Jim Muljenski, who is OpenSCG's CTO and chief architect, will be joining us for the talk on foreign data wrappers and generally data federation. So that's how the evening will set up. And I think we'll get started with Richard's retrospective.
Great, thank you so much.
Everybody put on your googly eyes.
Well, I'm really excited by where we're going, Jim. So the foreign data wrappers represents where we're going, where we are and where we're going. And I'm really excited by Bruce's talk. Bruce, help me with the pronunciation.
Momjian.
If you happen to catch his two talks this summer, very exciting. And one thing I'm looking forward to is maybe helping put forward the timeline of connecting the retrospective with where we're headed, where it's all been. But I observed that this summer happens to be the 20th anniversary, would have been a little earlier for me, of my joining the Postgres team at UC Berkeley. So in late 94 and culminating in with an actual deal in January of 95, Stonebreaker hired me on. I was to lead a 43-person team using Postgres as the foundational product to do earth science. And that put me not quite in the Postgres group, but immersed in the community and gave me, you know, office space and all. And so as I was thinking about all of that, I stumbled across this particular document, which is dated April 27th, 1994, entitled the Postgres User Manual, right? And it's a wonderful little document, and I'm gonna read to you a few little excerpts, but it kind of gives us a moment at this 20-year point to reflect a little bit. And I was having a great conversation before we started with Josh and others in the group about the dates involved. And so it was 20 years ago in the summer of 95 that the decisions were being made that that Stonebreaker didn't want to bring on any more grad students to work on Postgres. That wasn't going to be his thing anymore. And therefore, the community was saying, well, we want somebody to take on the ownership of the code, and it shouldn't be abandoned, and how do we do that? And they weren't happy about the open source, as such as it is known today, licensing of, for example, a BSD, right? So the Berkeley Standard Distribution, you know, and there were discussions about all that. And so I was right at ground zero. In fact, one of the merits of my own little position was I had this great big office space where I had a little beer fridge and I kept it stocked. And I remember we had this guy, Walensky, was our chair at the time, and he was always coming in and looking at the mountain of empty bottles. And I said, hey, you know, he was okay with that so long as we were all good people. And but the point being that my particular office space was a congregational for us, and And the Postgres community was really looking forward, and the decision was made at that time to add to Postgres SQL. And then at the same time, debates raged right there in my office about getting rid of Quell. And so this document is probably the last one that articulates Postgres with a Quell and not SQL language interface. And so when we review a document like this, it has so many charming things. And I'm trying to do a lightning talk and not just blabbering on. I want it to be of good value to you. And I thought that there were a couple of really interesting pieces here that I would share. And one of them was a little bit of the history, which they summarize here in just a couple of pages, because I think you'll find it interesting. It's less than a full page. It's slightly more than half a page of text. A short history of Postgres, the Postgres project. Implementation of the Postgres DBMS began in 1986. The initial concepts for the system were presented in Stone 86, and the definition of the initial data model appeared in Row 89. The design of the rule system at the time was described in Stone 87A. The rationale and architecture of the storage manager we detailed in Stone 87B. Postgres has undergone several major releases since then. The first, quote, demoware, end quote, system became operational in 87 and was shown at the 1988 ACM SIGMOD conference. We released version 1.0, as described in Stone 90A, to a few external users in June of 1989. In response to a critique of the first rule system, Stone 89, the rule system was redesigned in Stone 90B, and version 2.0 was released in June 90 with a new rule system. Version 3 appeared in 1991 and added support for multiple storage managers, an improved query executor, and rewrite rule system. For the most part, releases since then have focused on portability and reliability. Postgres has been used to implement many different research and production applications. These include a financial data analysis system, a jet engine performance monitoring package, an asteroid tracking database, a medical informatics database, and several geographical information systems. Postgres has been used as an educational tool at several universities, and finally, at least two companies, Multimedia Information Systems and Montage Software, have picked up the prototype code and commercialized it. Postgres became the primary data manager for the Sequoia 2000 Scientific Computing Project in late 1992. And by the way, let me insert, that's my project that I took over.
Because you're out of time.
Yeah, let me just finish the paragraph. Furthermore, the size and external user community nearly doubled during 1993 and became increasingly obvious that maintenance of the prototype code and support was taking up large amounts of time that should have been devoted to database research. In an effort to reduce this support burden, the project officially ended with version 4.2, and thus begins PostgreSQL. Thank you.
Okay, hello, my name is Adrian. Let me just log in here quickly.
We won't count that again.
Okay. So what I want to talk about is a framework that's fairly new that supports Postgres really well. There's a particular framework that uses Postgres as the default database, and thus the drivers and the interface for it that is written really well. I don't know how many of you do APIs or even web apps. I do a lot of web apps. I've been using a lot of Ruby on Rails like the last 7 years. And one of the problems in the Rails community is the active record. The active record code is, let's just say, a little fragile, and especially when it comes to Postgres. And there's been an effort to improve that over the last few years, and it has improved a little bit. But anyway, let me just dive into this, and I think you might find it interesting. So some of you may know there's a language called Erlang. I'm just going to go through some web pages that I pulled up here really quickly and string this together. Erlang's been around a long time, 29 years ago, 86. It supports massive concurrency. It's extremely reliable. Erlang's claim to fame is it's used in large telephone switching capital equipment that Ericsson produces. And there's a particular machine of legend that supposedly achieved nine sigmas, nine nines of reliability. Now, they say that the nine nines it really isn't nine nines, it's really like around seven nines, six to seven nines. That's still pretty good. A statement was made that it was only at nine nines for 6 months, and I don't know how you can make a statement like that. How can you say it's only nine nines for 6 months? That makes no sense whatsoever. So anyway, it's a very reliable language. There's an old myth that you can't have reliability and speed, and Erlang proves that wrong. Erlang is blazing fast, it's a compiled language, and it supports concurrency, and it's extremely, extremely reliable, really good stuff. So there's the Wikipedia page. There's a man named Joe Armstrong, who's kind of the principal architect of the language. He has some close collaborators. At Pragmatic, if you do a Google search, what's all this fuss about Erlang, there's a good little article that also points to the PDF of Joe's PhD dissertation on concurrency and reliability. He's basically devoted his life to those issues. And has been very successful with Erlang. So fast forward into the 2000s, there's a young man named José Filim from Brazil, and I have pictures of people pulled up here. He's a really nice guy, and he produced this. Okay, here's José. He's a really nice young guy. He lives in Poland now, just had a baby. And he's a very talented, he was one of the primary Rails core developers, and then he kind of left Rails. And what he did was, he came up with a language called Elixir, which is kind of analogous to CoffeeScript, is to JavaScript. He made Erlang more like Ruby and easier to use, but he also added a bunch of new functions to it to support things like I18N internationalization, better string handling, and he's also interested in web protocols. So what he's done is With Elixir, he's also done some work to do some drivers for HTTP2 protocol, which uses chunking and out-of-order delivery. And this is an area where Erlang and Elixir excel. So he then collaborated with a couple of other fellows, and they came up with this Phoenix framework. It's a web framework, but right now it's more suitable for APIs. It builds on top of Elixir and Erlang, so it's really fast, it's reliable, all that good stuff. It scales really well, small memory footprint. And the thing I liked about Phoenix is that it's a framework that supports Postgres out of the box as their go-to primary database, and it works really well with that. And I just wanted to share really quickly, José Vilim tweets a lot, and he tweeted September 7th, plus, if you don't care about your data, Phoenix 102 supports database MongoDB on Mix. So you gotta like a guy who says something like that. So I just wanted to share that there is a good framework. If you want to do APIs, I've used it for APIs, a couple of them, and it's really fast, it's really solid, and it works really great with Postgres. So nothing earth-shattering, but it's always good to have another friend and ally in the world. And so now you know that that Postgres has a new friend, and it's a framework called Phoenix, and it's in the language called Elixir, built on Erlang. So, and big success story is WhatsApp. That's the big success story they point to in the Erlang world. So, anyway, that's it. Just wanted to share that.
Thank you very much.
Well, one sentence I forgot in my talk. Simran Taylor here, this gentleman drinking water, is mentioned in this manual I was just reading out of. In the user notes, his name is one of the examples.
Okay. Okay. So I have some announcements. Well, Jim gets set up. So first of all, upcoming stuff. Number one, people know that there's a conference this month. Yes? Anybody not know that there's a conference this month? Right, yeah, there we go. There's a conference this month. How many people actually registered? A few people. Look, it's right here in the Bay Area. So I mailed out to the meetup group a discount code. It's like SFPUG20.
Yeah.
And it gets you 20% off whatever you want to register for.
Yeah, 20% off what? Do you remember?
I don't remember. So we're sponsoring, so that took care of my registration. The which actually means my registration was much more expensive than other people's well-being.
Fair enough.
The but that's awesome. You should go. It's going to be, you know, it's a full day, four tracks, which means, you know, in any given time slot, there's three things you wish you could see and can't. And there's a day of tutorials before the main talk day. So that's the sort of next thing that we have coming up. You know, and please register. It's going to be an awesome event. And you wish that you'd gone if you don't. The other thing is the South Bay division of the Postgres user group
right.
is going to take advantage of some people being in town for the conference and hold a meetup the following evening. So the conference is Tuesday and Wednesday. They're going to hold a meetup on Thursday evening down in Palo Alto. That meetup will have two presenters, maybe three presenters. It's going to be at Tableau, if you know them, reporting software and analytics software. So it's going to be at Tableau. They're going to show a little bit of using their stuff with Postgres. And then Alvaro Tortosa is going, I don't know what he's going to talk about, but he's an awesome guy. This is Alvaro Tortosa of the Billion Tables Project, among other things.
Did they advertise to the rest of us through the meetup?
Yeah, it's all a meetup. Right, it's all a meetup.
Yeah.
So there's going to be that. Then on December 9th, we're going to have another East Bay meeting, right? What's
yes.
the... Do you have all the details for that?
It is not super-duper official, but...
Okay.
Yeah.
Tentatively, pencil in on December 9th, that we will have an East Bay May meetup at Iperidums, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Isn't there some kind of after-hour cocktail thing that you announced on the meetup as well?
Oh, yeah, that's true also, yes. If for some reason you can't go to the actual conference because you can't get time off or, you know, you're broke or whatever else, or registration sells out, which would be awesome as far as I'm concerned. But if for some reason you can't go to the conference, the cocktail reception on the tutorial night, so on the 17th, is actually open to all members of SFPUC. So if you just want to drop by there so that you can schmooze with some of the people who are in town for the conference, because you can't come to the conference otherwise, then please join us for that. And again, that's been posted in the meetup room. So
thank you.
That's Tuesday, yeah. So that's what we've got upcoming. And then the other thing that we have scheduled already is another South Bay meetup for the first week of January. Some topic to be announced. We'll probably have another one here in the city the second week of January, but that's kind of hypothetical at this point. So that's for upcoming events. If you wanted to go to Postgres Europe, sorry you missed it was last week. So too late now. The next sort of big international Postgres event is going to be FOSDEM. The next US-based one, which is a little bit sooner than that, will be two days, one track of Postgres at Southern California Linux Expo.
It's 2 days, two
in
tracks.
Pasadena. 2 days, two tracks?
Yep.
Does he really have enough talk submissions for that?
Yeah.
Yeah? Okay. So we have a ton of Postgres stuff at Southern California Linux Expo in Pasadena. And the great thing about scale is that the most expensive part is getting there. The most expensive part is accommodations, actually, really, because you can drive there. Because it's an inexpensive conference, and again, lots of Postgres stuff. Very easy to talk your boss into forking out for that, since they pretty much just have to pay for a hotel room, right? So that's what we've got in events. So other stuff going on in Postgres development. Next week, we're going to release 9.5 Beta 2.
Yay.
Yeah. How many people tested Beta 1?
Fine.
People test Beta 1? Okay. I am going to write a guide for upgrading from 9.4 to 9.5 using UDR. Really, I am.
Is it correct we won't have to worry about it after this, right?
Well, the idea is that as of 9.4, you can do upgrades via replication. But somebody needs to actually document how to do that, which
okay.
I think is going to be me.
Okay.
But I've been kind of busy lately. So.
All right.
But that will get done before we release 9.5.
Yeah.
I can't promise it'll get done any sooner than that.
All right.
So anyway, so please download, test the beta again. put your own applications on it, because it's only by doing all of the weird stuff that people do with Postgres that we're going to find out those weird corner cases of use this feature with that feature with a high transaction load, it does, you know.
Right.
So it would be better to know that before 9.5.0 than afterwards. Mm-hmm. So then in Postgres development, obviously what's being developed right now is 9.6. We've actually had, for this commit fest, we've had the first really sort of interesting features. Wait, which tab is that? There we go. So, up for review, because we just started the current commit fest. So by the way, if anybody feels like reviewing patches and testing stuff out, we always need help with that. Because in any given, you know, quarter in Postgres, we have something on the order of 100, 120 patch submissions. And our biggest restriction in the ability to put out cool stuff in the Postgres project is how fast we can review code and test stuff. Yeah?
I just wanted to comment on that. I think it would be nice if there was a little more tool support for doing that.
Yeah.
It's kind of, there's a certain amount of setup, and if you're just thinking,
yeah,
I've got an hour and I can take a look at something.
Yeah.
And the hour's up, and you know, you can get there.
Okay. That'd be good. I mean, I did, last year I did this thing where I actually had AMIs up and like free time from Amazon, and only two people ever took advantage of it.
Well, so, yeah, I didn't hear about that one.
And it was tough to arrange.
Yeah, and we also had a meetup where we tried to do it.
Yeah.
And we spent a lot of time doing setup.
In support of that, I think more formalized efforts are welcome by this community, and here in the Bay, you might get a lot
of
support.
Well, so maybe that's what we should do in January, which would be a test fest. I don't know. We'll think about it.
Maybe valuable prizes or something.
Like t-shirts.
Yeah, but so among the things that are up for review to get you excited about this, parallel sequential scan.
Yay.
So we finally actually got the first major deliverable from the parallel query project.
Yay.
And that's parallel sequential scan.
That's a big deal for performance.
So and the next bit in foreign data wrappers, which is join pushdown, so doing the join on the opposite side of the foreign data wrappers, which is a big deal for people who want to do federated databases. The what was the other sort of big one? Oh, right. I never doing vacuum freeze again. So we figured out a way to effectively have de facto 64-bit transaction IDs. Do people actually know what vacuum freeze is for and what like XID wrapper is?
Re-articulate for us. Go ahead.
So Postgres has a transaction ID counter that's 32-bit, which means it runs out after 2.4 billion transactions or 2.2 billion transactions, whichever one that is, and has to be recycled. So we're constantly looking, and the thing is, transaction IDs are actually stored in the tables. And so the auto vacuum worker is constantly scanning the tables in order to erase the really old transaction IDs so that they can be reused. Problem is, what people run into as a case all the time is either vacuum is broken on, auto vacuum is broken on their system for some reason and they didn't realize it, or they just have a really big table that's effectively append only, like your log table. And so then the problem is that normally vacuum doesn't visit that table at all until the transaction IDs run out, at which point all of a sudden this 370 gigabyte log table that hasn't really been touched in 2 years has to be vacuumed end to end. And you're like, why is my server so slow?
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, if this solution works, we're going to go to that. If this solution works, then at current transaction rates, that only has to be vacuumed about once every 150 years.
Yay!
Although what that will probably just mean is that people will up their transaction rates. So the I know, it's like 64 bits now. It's like, oh, it's 150 years. It'll last forever, right?
Yeah.
That's what we used to say about 32 bits. Yep. It'll last 10 years, and the computers are enough faster that people really will be doing a million transactions per second, at which point it'll run out
And we'll have to do everything to go 128-bit.
Yes. Yeah. So those are big ones. Integrated, Thomas Bonder's been working on integrated columnar storage in Postgres.
Oh, yeah.
So like the C store extension that we already have for earlier versions of Postgres.
but this time actually integrated as an option inside Postgres.
Yeah.
That's probably fairly work in progressy at this point.
Are you looking at that? Are we looking at that in the current release?
Those are the big ones. Those are kind of the big ones in terms of what's in the current commit fest. Although obviously, people's opinions of what's the most important patch really depends on your own individual use cases. So take a look. And that's all I have for announcements. Did somebody else have something?
Thanks, Dave.
Welcome, Jim.
Thank you.
Jim, I was going to say Jim flew in from Vienna just for this, but I'd be lying. He actually was doing some client work in the East Bay.
But did you just fly in from Vienna?
I did just fly in from Vienna.
Wonderful.
But it was on Sunday night.
Oh, well, close enough.
I was out at the European Postgres Conference there, which was fantastic. They had 400 people. Great conference, a lot of fun. They were up from 320 last year. So really seeing the great growth of Postgres. The European conference is definitely the gold standard of what we want to follow as conference organizers. But it was a lot of fun and got a chance to meet all the European community members, which you only get to do once a year when you go out there. They didn't announce where next year's going to be yet, but they're thinking Copenhagen, Berlin, who knows? But they ran out of time in order to organize it before the conference this year. So we'll see. So I'm going to talk about Federated Postgres. Quickly, who am I? Jim Wilgenski. I'm a East Coast guy. I'm one of the organizers of New York City PUG and Philadelphia PUG. New York City is a kind of fun where we get nice, big, lively crowds. It helps when you got millions of people all on a small island. We tried to do something similar to what you guys are doing here of spreading it out. Tried to do something in Brooklyn, tried to do something in Jersey. Nobody showed up. Everybody just wanted to go Manhattan, so we decided just to keep it there. Philly's a little bit of a different animal. The stuff in Center City is pretty cool, but when you go out to the suburbs, we start getting more and more people showing up there. So we're starting to do more meetups out in the suburbs of Philly. Philly's also kind of a cool little phenomenon in that there's a lot of major contributors of Postgres right in that small little city. Between Bruce Momgin, Peter Eisentrout, two core members, show up all the time. You also get Robert Haas, lives right across the river. Jan Vijk is right there, as well as a couple PostGIS committers are in there. It's kind of, I don't know how they all ended up in Philly, but they're all there. So we never have a shortage of talks in Philly, because I could just call one of them and say, hey, can you talk for a little bit? It's kind of fun going to talk to other PUGs when I'm in the area, just seeing how you guys do things differently. So I could learn a little bit more about how we could do things in Philly and New York. Every town, every city is a little bit different.
We'd love to have you as a regular contributor here.
Well, it's a long trip, but when I'm out this way, I'd be more than happy to stop by. It is funny to see that the different personalities, all the different PUGs around the country. They're all kind of unique. So, federated databases. So the idea of these have been around for a long time. About 10 years ago, Jay Voss bought a company called Metamatrix, and they were doing things like federated databases. So the concept of these have been around for a long time. Of a federated database in being that all your data resides in foreign sources, and then you're running queries against something that proxies those queries out there everywhere else, but the data is all in the original sources. So you never actually pull the data in, replicating it in. It all stays in its main source system. And they don't necessarily have to be all in the same data center. They could be geographically dispersed. So it gives you a lot of power, but you have to understand the pros and cons of doing that sort of approach. Sometimes it's pretty cool, but you could also shoot yourself in the foot with that sort of power. Postgres does it through the concept of foreign data wrappers. These got introduced back in 9.1, and every version started adding more and more features to it. implements the spec for the ANSI spec for SQL Med, stands for Management of External Data. So it is fairly compliant, even though Postgres really is the only database that implements this thing. I think there's another one if you check Wikipedia, but really, Oracle doesn't really want to connect to everybody else. They just want to suck everything in. Same thing with Microsoft and IBM. They don't want to work nicely with all the other databases. So Postgres is kind of in a unique position to be able to do something like this. Because if you want to keep your data in Oracle and some of it in Postgres, that's all right. You have corporate things that you need to do, whereas Oracle wants to take over the world. So basically the way it looks is you run your queries against Postgres. And Postgres is more or less the dispatcher of those queries out to all those remote data sources. So in theory, you could actually join data from Oracle, from Mongo, from Postgres, from Hadoop, all in a single query, pull it back and spit it out in a single report. Don't do that, but you can do it. There's lots of things in Postgres that you can do that you shouldn't do. It has the ability to do that. But there are some pretty neat things you could do with it that are pretty, solve some specific business problems for you. It would be kind of fun just to do a demo of actually doing all those different data sources in a single query, but that query might take a little while. So there's a number of different types of foreign data wrappers. I split it up into a few different kind of groups. The SQL-based ones, and then the NoSQL ones. They're kind of the obvious ones. We have a number of different file foreign data wrappers. I chunk in the miscellaneous ones because some of them are just there for fun. They're weird. Other ones are there because they're useful, but they don't fit into the other groups as much. And I split off the Postgres one as its own special one because it is by far the most powerful, and it's probably the one that you're going to use most frequently. So as of maybe a month ago when I last looked, these are the SQL foreign data wrappers that are out there. There's a wiki page on there that lists them all out. The Oracle one has been getting a lot of attention lately, as well as the TDS one, so when you're connecting to Sybase and SQL Server. There is a SQLite one that's hasn't really been touched much lately. You can hit MySQL, Informix, or they have generic JDBC and ODBC ones. So you can pretty much hit any data source you want. These are fairly simple, and connecting to them makes a lot of sense when you're doing it, because you're connecting to another like system. You're going from a SQL front end in Postgres out to another SQL source of, say, Oracle, and everything all seems to make sense. So these are by far the easiest to understand when you're talking about connecting with other foreign sources. So setting it up, after you do a create extension for, let's say, the Oracle FDW, first thing you got to do is create a foreign server. So there you do a create server and you give it the foreign data wrapper information. And really you're going to give it the DB server name. That would be, say, the Oracle TNS information of how you connect to the database. Maybe the host port, depending on what it is, but that's your connection information out to that foreign Oracle source. Okay. Next thing you got to do is do a user mapping. Because you're connecting to your local Postgres system as your Postgres user, and you got to map that out to what your Oracle user is on the Oracle system. You can, depending on what your security policies are, you could route all your Postgres users through a single Oracle one, or you could do a one-for-one mapping. Right, so this one here is just for the current user, and we're mapping it out to the Scott Tiger. So any Oracle people know that the Scott Tiger is the default login from the old examples inside of Oracle.
Did that come from Sun? Scott McNeely, he's a tiger?
No, I think that it was one of the original Oracle employees. I don't know if Tiger was his pet or something like that. There was something like that was his default password back then. That was his name of his dog or something like that. You can check the history of that somewhere.
I have a more substantive observation, which is that over many of the database systems that you mentioned in SQL on the previous slide, I personally have written SQL translation engine, and I know that there's a lot of syntactic difference. And are you suggesting that for each of these someone has written this syntactic translation, or are we left to just that none of that occurs and you're up to your own whatever goes wrong? For example, one of the big ones, having done this, is the treating of nulls and how Oracle in particular silently translates a null string, an empty string into a null, which is vitally important in SQL semantics on what you expect back from your query. So
what, it's really up to the people implementing the foreign data wrapper, but by and large what they're doing is translating into very simple SQL that gets translated, that gets sent across. So select star from foo gets sent over.
So there's no semantic, and these issues are ignored, is basically what you're saying.
Right, the implementers of the foreign data wrappers have the ability to do some of that. So you can do things like push down functions out there, and you can do the translations of those sorts of things, but most of them don't implement that.
Yeah, I mean, the other thing is that the amount of SQL that you're going to be executing in the foreign data source or other languages, if it's not an SQL database, is fairly limited. I mean, as in, you know, except for unless the FDW implements some sort of, you know, random pass through a query as a string, you're strictly only getting tables.
Is that another way of saying that we expect that Postgres will be sending a tiny little sub portion of a query down to the lower,
handled in Postgres.
And you hope that what's, I don't mean to, I want you to go on with your talk, but simply, is there a way for us with Postgres to observe what the query being pushed down to the foreign data wrapper actually is?
Yes.
Oh, good. Okay, fine.
Yeah, and that's one of the later slides.
Oh, great. Thank you. I'm sorry.
No problem.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but his name was Bruce Scott. And his daughter's cat was named.
I knew it was something.
great. Now we know.
Right. I knew there was, you know, a logical reason why Scott Tiger was there, which makes sense. So once you've created that user mapping, then you can create your first foreign table. And you create the table same way you would do a normal Postgres table, but with some additional syntactic sugar. One of it, you say create foreign table instead of create table. And then you put in all your columns and data types. They're the Postgres data types. So here we're connecting to Oracle, and we're calling department number int and not number. Right? And the foreign data wrapper will do that translation and casting under the covers. As long as there, it could do the casting, it'll do it.
At the data type level, you mean?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep. And then you tell it which server you're going to. This is the Oracle server, and then all the foreign data wrappers have different options on there. So when you're connecting to the Oracle one, you want to tell it which schema and which table on the Oracle side that you're going to do. So once you do that foreign table, you could do a select star from department, limit one, and you're going to be able to get all the data out of Oracle, and it'll show up through PSQL. Right? So it'll look and feel like a Postgres table to you.
Do we get good error messages about when the data types don't quite match, for example? I mean,
it depends. Your mileage will vary based on your foreign data wrapper.
Right.
Right.
So who wrote it, right?
Exactly.
Okay.
The Oracle one is fairly good. It basically bubbles up the messages from the Oracle client, and you can see that sort of thing. Other ones are just kind of eats it, and they were more their proof of concepts than anything else. Right,
so, thank you.
So do some testing depending on which ones you're using. So the NoSQL ones, this is where it starts getting interesting, where you have things like Mongo, Redis, Cassandra, where you're able to connect Postgres to these sorts of different sites. So in New York, you get a large number of MongoDB people showing up at our pubs. I think out here you get more Cassandra usage. It seems to be like depending on what coast you're on, which one you get. So we get a lot of Mongo people showing up, who implemented their applications in Mongo, and they show up in Postgres and say, hey, our managers have said, hey, we want reporting on this application, and the only way we can get reporting is you have to write Python code or something in order to generate a report out of Mongo, because you got to parse all this stuff. This is where the foreign data wrappers on those NoSQL ones come into real handy. because you can pull the stuff in the Postgres and run reports. You can even put things like Crystal Reports on top of it and get it through Mongo and do some interesting things. All right, so here's for folks in the back, it might be a little bit small, but this is one of Mongo's example JSON data sets, which is just a bunch of zip codes throughout the US. Right? So it's in a Mongo collection, right? And there, if you do find, it'll return back the JSON of all the zip codes in the US along with their latitude and longitude and the name of the town and the name of the state, right? Which is, when you're a web developer coming back at JSON, it's pretty simple until you say, hey, give me a report of all the population in a specific county. And then you got to pull all that stuff back and write some code in order to really get that answer back and have it produce something meaningful for you. Lo and behold, the Postgres foreign data wrapper for MongoDB. Right? So here you do create server to your Mongo server. And here you give it the connection information to your Mongo server. And then you create a foreign table called zips. Right? And that first column has to be underscore ID, because that's how Mongo looks for everything. And then you define all the rest of them, which matches to that JSON document that's in there. And things like location, it's an array, numeric array, because that's latitude and longitude. There's multiple things in there, so it's an array inside the JSON, so we map that to a Postgres array. And there we'll do a database of zips and collection of zips. And lo and behold, now we could run select star from zips for state equals New Jersey, and all that stuff comes back out of Mongo looking like normal rows and columns like it should be, instead of putting everything in JSON. All right, so it's a quick, easy way to get stuff out of Mongo, or it could be Cassandra, any of those other foreign data things that have a foreign data wrapper implemented for it, and start looking at it in more of a relational way, depending on how you need to do it. It's also a really easy, good way to do a migration out of Mongo into Postgres. You want to get that data out into Postgres when you come to your senses and you get off of Mongo. Mm-hmm. Any questions? So I really don't know how it behaves, if the JSON kind of changes midstream throughout that stuff. If the keys aren't there, I think it just sticks nulls in there. So if you don't have everything all defined completely, it just sticks nulls in there.
That's right.
Yeah.
Does the insert work from
Postgres? Can you insert into that one? I don't know if the Mongo one's writable. I don't think it is.
No, it's not. When we wrote it, it was the update API wasn't there,
yeah.
Even. And then later on it came by, but we didn't update it.
Yeah, I know EDB did an update to it too. I don't know if they made that writable.
I don't think so. But yeah. Maybe,
So the file wrappers, these are ones that I end up using a lot more. So. The delimited file one is one of the two foreign data wrappers that's part of the contrib modules in Postgres, so it gets shipped as part of the core. The other ones are add-on extensions. Use these quite a bit when you want to do data loads in order to bring things in and not necessarily do a copy into a temp table and then kind of manipulate it and move it into the final table, or you want to do some pre-checking before you put it in your final table. It's a way to load your data and use it without fully loading it into a table. The other one, the PG dump one, is kind of handy. So if you have a giant dump file, instead of doing a PG restore, you could actually use the foreign data wrapper to read that data out and then do whatever you need to. So if you only need five rows, you don't have to load the whole table. You can just grab those five rows out.
I gotta say, that's clever. I like that.
So that one you could thank a guy named Jonah Harris out in the Philly area that did that one. It was it is kind of handy. They have a disturbing use case for it. Well, it actually is disturbing in that they're a social media company called MeetMe, and they have to go back in history, look at all the backups for. When they have subpoenas for people who file molesters and stuff like that.
So somebody should do a talk about that.
Yeah.
Because that's really cool.
It's cool that they could do it. I hate the reason why they have
to. Well, I agree.
So
with that.
So it is it's kind of a disturbing reason why they have to go back 6 months or a year of those backups and look for specific records based on a user ID, and they don't want to load that over and over again. That's why he wrote it. It is useful that you're able to get that sort of thing out and be able to pull up those handful of rows. without restoring the entire table.
One, I also want to mention, there's a second optional CSV one
mm-hmm.
that instead of loading stuff into columns, loads it as an array of text.
Oh, cool.
Which means it's useful for CSV files that don't have an even number of columns.
Yeah. That is a cool one. So here is the file FTW again.
What about for loading some, say, unbalanced CSV, and you want to put it into a JSON column in Postgres?
Well, you'd start with the CSV array one.
Yeah.
And then convert that to JSON.
Yeah, because once you have that, then you have it as basically a table, and you can use any of Postgres' built-in functions. Like this one, if you wanted to load in a file that has a bunch of leads in it, some sales guy gave you an export out of his Excel spreadsheet, CSVs. And if you notice, the format of that looks a lot like the copy command. A lot of the code in there was taken from the implementation of the copy command. You have a lot of the same options there. So you get a format CSV, whether or not you have the headers there. But what it does is it lets you access that file through Postgres as a foreign table and not have to load it directly into a table yet. So that sort of scenario where you load it into a temp table, scrub it in some way, and then load it into the final table. It lets you skip that loading it into a temp table. So it makes things simpler. You don't have to do a two-step process. You can just load it once. And the other thing is you can just swap that file out from underneath it. If you get a new file every day, it could just be there and you could have that same foreign table there if you want. And so you could do the concatenating the first name and the last name to get the full name. Usually you split it out, but for this example, you're just concatenating. You can use normal Postgres syntax.
Can you read etc password then?
Yeah, you can. If the Postgres user has access to that, right? So this is running in the context of the Postgres user.
Yes. You. By the way, you actually can use some of these text ones to, for example, read pghba.com.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Does the definition of the columns have to be in order that they're laid out in the CSV file? Or does it know if you have headers true how to...
No, it has to be in the order. Same as copy.
Yeah, okay.
Now, somebody could write, like, for the CSV, somebody could write an improved version that would read a header, but nobody has yet.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, the header just, when you say header's true, it just skips the first line.
Okay.
Hmm.
Same is true for the copy command. If you say header's true, it just skips the first line.
Interesting.
Miscellaneous. So there's a whole bunch of ones that are here that are implemented as foreign data wrappers that don't fit into one of the other categories. So the CStore one from the Citus guys, it's implementing the column store. Even though it's not a foreign table, it's on the local thing, but it's using the foreign data wrapper APIs. The pgstrom one's an interesting thing, where it leverages the GPU in order to speed up some queries. People have experimented writing a Twitter and a MailChimp foreign data wrapper, just kind of for fun that you could do it. LDAP one could be useful. And probably another half a dozen or so more that are on there that they're just, some of them are useful, some are fun. But we'll get into the Hadoop one. So the Hadoop foreign data wrapper, there's a couple different pieces to it. The first one is accessing everything through Hive. So here you connect your forms to your foreign server, connecting it to your local Hive server. There you create your foreign table out there, to your order line. And there, the way that we typically use the Hadoop foreign data wrapper is we don't try to run those big Hive MapReduce queries. What we do is more for staging data and refreshing, say, materialized summary views inside of Postgres. When you have a dashboard, you might have your daily sales, weekly sales, and loading that in, but all your detail is sitting there in Hadoop.
Does this have read-write capability?
This one does, yeah. Not all of them do, but the Hadoop one does.
Thank you.
So here you can insert into the Postgres table item sales month, and you're going to run the query from the order line table that's sitting down and into Hadoop. You know, maybe a nightly batch job that you might be running in order to stage some data inside of Postgres. Postgres has great low latency queries, whereas Hadoop has the big number crunching things. If you want to have your main dashboards going out to your CEO hitting Hadoop data, it's probably not the right thing. You save getting something like Postgres. So here it is being writable. So when you're doing things with Hive and HDFS, it's really an append-only type system. So you can, this foreign data wrapper lets you do things through Flume. Flume is a way to get data into Hadoop and HDFS. So if you do an insert into a table, it'll push it in through Flume and get it in, and it'll append it to the end of the HDFS table. That's eventual consistent. So for something like an audit table, you kind of want that. You want that outside of Postgres, because otherwise your super user can go ahead and fix those tables. So you want to do an insert as quickly as possible, get it off the server, and have it someplace where you can audit all the different things that are happening inside there. But it'll let you push everything through Flume for this particular case. The Hadoop foreign data wrapper also works with HBase. HBase gives you a little bit more flexibility, and that lets you do inserts, updates, and deletes. Right, so here you can map things to a key value, and there you can do inserts, updates, deletes on the HBase side of it as well. Again, this is leveraging Hive in order to be able to get there. Right, so we never really decided whether or not we wanted to use one of the newer technologies in order to do SQL over Hadoop, but so Hive's been there for a while. It leverages that in order to get access your stuff in HBase.
You use the word we. Are you involved in that project?
Yeah, I wrote most of that.
Wow, thank you.
So yeah, we ended up doing quite a bit of it, because we ended up doing a lot of Hadoop stuff with Postgres stuff out in a lot of our customers. Thank you. So we needed a way to integrate some of these things. The WWW wrapper. This one's kind of fun, but it's also a way to access things like REST APIs from Postgres if you need to. So this one's just kind of a fun one where you're leveraging things over Google's API. So you could write a query of, show me the Google results where it says, or Postgres, for everything that says Postgres FDW. Right, so it makes the query out to Google, returns that back as a table. Or looking like a table to you. Probably don't really want to do this as part of your main application. But sometimes you want to do like data verification. Is all the data in my table here matching the results I get from, say, a Salesforce API call? Right? Do I have all my customers in both places? Right? Those sorts of things you can do. Or depending on what API you want to hit, it lets you be able to access that. Again, remember, just because you can do it doesn't mean you should, but it is one of the cool things that you can do with Postgres. Right. Postgres foreign data wrapper. This is the one that you'll end up using most frequently because you want to connect to another Postgres database. It may be even a Postgres database on the same cluster. So this way you can't do cross-database joins inside of Postgres the way you can in Sybase or SQL Server. With the foreign data wrapper, you can. If you want to be able to do that, if you have different databases on your same instance and you want to be able to join data across, it lets you do that. It replaces a lot of the functionality of DB-Link, but not all of it. Foreign data wrappers are still maturing. DB-Link lets you push down just an arbitrary SQL statement and be able to handle that. You can't do things, for instance, like call functions on a remote server with foreign data wrappers, because you're wrapping the tables. With DB-Link, you can call remote functions. And this, along with the file FDW, is shipped as one of the contrib modules. So here I found a sample data set for bird strikes, being in New York with Sully landing on the Hudson. I thought it was an interesting data set. It also has a lot of different columns in there. To be able to do it. So you're connecting to it. So I'm connecting to port 5432 on the database named test2. I'm running in database test1. And here we'll create the same user mappings. And again, this just like a regular Postgres table definition, except that you have the, at the end, server, and what the options are. And basically, all you need is the table name, Birdstrikes. Something to be aware of, if you're running in the public schema, say on your local one, and you need to be, the matching table has to be on the same public schema. So if you want to do cross schema things, you have to put a schema name in there in addition to table name. So it won't automatically, so say we were in a local schema of, we did a foo.birdstrikes, you have to have a foo.birdstrikes on the other side. Otherwise you have to explicitly say the schema name that's in there. Little gotcha that ended up finding out last week in Vienna. So here's how you find out what query is being sent over to the remote server. You do an explain verbose. And you see we'll do select airport, flight date from Birdstrikes. Nice thing about the Postgres foreign data wrapper, it's only going to ask for the columns that it cares about. Right? Some of them will do a select star from Birdstrikes or something like that, depending on how lazy the guys that implemented the foreign data wrapper was, if it was just for fun or if they're doing it for production. The Postgres one does limit it just the columns that it cares about. It also sends down a where clause. Not all of them do that. So sometimes it might do select star from foo and apply the where clause on the local Postgres server. The Postgres one does, the Oracle one does, the Hadoop one does. There's a bunch of them that push down the where clause. But here you can start seeing a little bit more about how Postgres is changing the query that gets sent down a little bit. So it'll cast that to a timestamp without time zone, as well as putting things in parentheses. So it's doing a little bit more to the query other than just taking the query that you typed in and pushing it down. Right? It parses it and then reconstructs it as it sends it down. So it's fairly close, but it's not exact because it's gone through the parsing step already on the local Postgres database.
I have a question about the time zones.
Yep.
If you have different time zone sets on different databases, does this let you cope with that at all?
Yeah, the Postgres one will push down all your local settings are to the remote one. I forget where it does that, but it does do something where it tries to adjust those sorts of things like collations and time zones, so this way you get a consistent thing across everything.
Which can be interesting if the collation doesn't exist on the remote server.
Yeah, you get the edge, exactly.
Last talk, Josh spoke about explain and analyze, and I'm wondering, do we get the analyze explain verbose as well as the explain verbose? In other words,
not going to do a remote explain or a remote analyze, explain analyze.
Yeah, I get that it's not going to tell us how the remote engine is going to do it. Mm-hmm. But when Josh, you know, how does this?
Well, you'll see timing, and yeah.
So when we're,
but it's all from the client end.
But
right?
When we're looking at a big query with all of the different parts of it, and we've got the two different forms of it, are we going to get this feature in both of those forms? Where the one is where it's without all of the detail, and the other with all the detail. Or can we also get this syntax output to us? In other words,
explain verbose analyze.
Yeah.
Yes. Well, yeah. Explain verbose analyze is a construct.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. It's there. It's just you're not going to get the analyze piece from the remote one. It's just going to give you
right.
It was a remote call, and get that back. You won't get all those the details from the remote server.
But we can do the analyze and get this query somewhere in yeah. our.
What I'd recommend is if you're doing anything with foreign data wrappers, don't do it in a big complex query. Do it very simply, where it's very easy to debug
yeah.
and look at. And then tie that into a bigger query some other way. So this, don't try to
yeah.
do a 12 table join and one of them being a foreign table.
Somebody will, but okay, thank you.
You can do it, don't do it.
So it does send down built-in immutable functions. Couldn't figure out a good thing to send down, so I looked for the length of the airport name being less than 10 characters. But that does send it down to the other remote server. So what that doesn't send down are the date functions because of the time zones. They're not immutable. But it does send that lengths, those sorts of things. It does send it down.
Wait,
to
you want to do but only built-in immutable functions?
Just built-in ones. The Apache just went in by Paul Ramsey mm-hmm. to be able to put down additional yeah. functions that just went in like this week, I think.
Mm.
So this way you can push down things like PostGIS functions down. But the way it is right now, it's just built-in immutable functions. Because it doesn't know that that immutable function exists on the other server.
I care a lot about PostGIS. Any further comment on that?
Well,
I mean, yeah. he's talking about pushing it down to foreign data wrappers.
Yeah, so in 9.6, you'll be able to push down, say, PostGIS functions out to a remote server.
Very cool.
Whereas today, you can't. Today it's going to pull back all the data locally and apply those functions locally.
Thank you.
The Postgres wrapper is writable, so it handles inserts, updates, deletes. How it handles it is pretty interesting, where this is where having the too many columns becomes a little more difficult. But it's going to, the first thing it's going to do, you know, you're looking at explain plans, you usually read from the bottom up, right? So the first thing it's doing is, doing a select for update, right? So it's going to lock that remote row that's getting there, and it's getting back the CTID. So there's, you don't know, CTID is really the physical location of where that row is on disk, you know, the block number and the slot number that's there. It's one of those hidden columns on there that you do a select CTID comma star, you can see where all those, that information, Xmin and Xmax are all, it relates back to what Josh was saying about having the transaction IDs on the individual rows. You can actually see what they are by looking at Xmin and Xmax. But the first thing it does is it locks that remote row and pulls back the CTID. And then it'll go ahead and then run that remote update for that CTID. So it locks it and then it goes and does it by using the CTID and looks it up again.
Cool.
The other cool thing is writes, the other Postgres databases are transactional.
Yep. Are CTID updates efficient?
Are they efficient? Yes, they're very efficient.
So it uses it directly?
Yeah. Yeah, you could.
Okay.
Yeah, CTID is.
Okay.
Yeah, it's because it's the physical location on there, so it is very, very fast. It's a great way to delete duplicate rows too. If you have two of them, you want to only delete one of them.
So you need. But,
yeah.
But. So the thing is, it's not necessarily fast if you do it in SQL.
Yeah, that's my question. But it seems like it has to do.
No, because if you do it in SQL, then it's just going to scan the whole table.
That's what I thought.
No,
the difference is no, because if you're doing it through a mechanism like this, and you're doing it through, you actually do a different look.
No, if you do it through SQL, there's a TID scan. It's not a sequential scan. So it goes directly to it. So if you do an explain analyze on something where you're looking it up by CTID, it's a different scan type. It's not a sequential scan, it's a TID scan, which is a lot faster.
Yeah, given the CTID, we should be able to go directly to the page and
So apparently Josh and I both thought the same thing, because that was my understanding too. So is that something that got introduced sometime, you know, since I stopped paying attention or something?
No, it's been there for a while, I believe. But it is very efficient, because it does use a different scan type instead of a sequential scan. It uses a TID scan. So writes are transactional. So if you're connecting to, you wanted to sync up two Postgres databases in a single transaction, you can do, so here we're gonna look up an airport for unknown, and what we're gonna do is start a transaction. We'll do a begin, and we'll set the unknown to all capitals instead of init capped, and then we'll roll it back. So this way it never actually changes. So this way, if you wanna be able to in a single transaction, write to a table locally and write to another Postgres database and keep those in sync, kind of real poor man's replication, right? You can do that sort of thing.
So given that we're talking to potentially foreign data engines, mm-hmm. which may or may not be transactional at all, the implication here, and I'm asking the question, mm-hmm. is that it's not actually going to do the write until the commit occurs.
Well, yeah, with Postgres, it uses two-phase commits in order to be able to do that.
But many of these mechanisms you listed don't necessarily have two-phase commits.
Again, your mileage will vary based on which developer you're going to use.
We're talking about the Postgres.
This is just the Postgres one.
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah. Never mind.
Yeah. Okay. So.
Yeah, we're limited to the PostgreSQL wrapper. Right?
Oops,
my bad.
So yeah, it's
thanks
some
for
of
that.
Them don't even have transactions. Some of them are eventually consistent.
Yeah. I mean, but obviously Postgres has it. Okay, fine. Yeah. Never mind.
Some of the limitations: aggregates are not pushed down. So if you do a select count star from it, what it's sending down is select null from bird strikes. So it's going to return back all the rows and then count them up on the local Postgres server. So things like sums, averages, you got to pull them all back and then do it all on the local server.
Ouch.
So it can be.
There's a WIP for that for 9.6, I think.
Yeah, so some of that is starting to be worked on, where at least some of the built-in aggregates will be able to do that. But yeah, that's a painful one, because a lot of times you want to do this in different reporting type scenarios, and you don't want to pull back a million rows or a billion rows and count them all. It'd be nice to just give me back one row of what the count is. Other ones: order bys, group bys, limits, they're not pushed down. So those two are all applied on the local one. Again, 9.6, this is one of them, doing remote sorts. Especially when you're talking about other foreign data, foreign sources other than Postgres, where you're doing parallels, like a Greenplum, a Citus, a Redshift, those sorts of things. Being able to push down that order by and do those order bys in parallel across multiple servers, you get a lot of advantages to doing that.
The parallel thing, I wonder if I have joined remote A, remote B, remote C.
Uh-huh.
Are all of those things running parallel, or is it going to?
How about I get to the next slide? Okay. Joins are not pushed down.
Ah.
Right. So if you're joining two remote tables, even if it's on the same source, it does a sequential scan there and one at a time, and then sequentially do the second scan and pull it all back and join it locally.
So it creates a triple store for both sides and then does the join.
Yeah, it pulls it all back locally. Yeah, exactly.
Is the remove to change that?
Yes.
Thank you.
So in 9.5, they had the first little pieces of the API to do that with the custom scan API, and it's going to be more robust in 9.6. Some of those
Great.
Patches are going in to be able to do those sorts of things. But this is definitely a limitation. So all these limitations that we've just talked about here, the way I get around with it is create a view on the foreign side. Right, and then call that view as a foreign table.
Yeah.
So if you know you want to join a couple tables and do an aggregate in it, you could do that in a remote view and then just treat that as a foreign table.
If it has a view.
Right. So those sorts of things, you probably have a standard report and you create those views ahead of time.
Makes sense.
Right. So that's temporary workaround until we get some more of these other things built out. Another limitation is that just because it looks like a table doesn't mean like it acts like a table. Like you said, some of these things don't have transactions.
Mm-hmm.
So this query here, where I'm going to take that leads from that CSV file that I have, and I want to geocode all those addresses by using Google's Geocoder API. When I do that join, I get no rows back. Right? So nothing happens. And what's happening is, when you look at the explain plan, the first thing that it's going to do is try to call a geocoder API with no query, right? So it's going to return back no rows, and joining no rows with those 500 rows in that CSV file, you get back nothing. But there's no real way to, the way that the geocoder API works is you have to have Q equals, right? And be able to send that in. You have to send in a query in order to be able to work. So it looks like a table, but it's not really a table. So I tried a bunch of ways of doing it with like CTEs in order to force it. The only way that I really was able to get it is to create a function in order to do it. Of first pulling out all the leads and getting the address, and then one at a time inside of a cursor, sending that in where address equals, and then passing that in one at a time.
This is on the Postgres side that you're doing all this?
Yes, this is on the Postgres server, yeah.
I assume you try to correlate it subquery?
Yep. Okay. Yep. Yep, it's you have to pass, you know, for that one www wrapper, you have to have this where something equals in order to have it sent in. Right? And the only way to really do that, in order to force that coming in, is explicitly do it in a function.
Do you consider that a bug? I mean,
No, it's you're trying to have a something that's non-relational behave relational.
Yes. Okay.
So it's not really a bug. It's just something you have to realize that.
Well,
when you're
to re-articulate my question is, do you perceive as a coder in Postgres a future where we won't have to do this trick? You know, Postgres can recognize the pattern and say, okay, fine, I need to pull this out from here to get the data flowing to me. I've got to do something like that, because this seems like an artificial construct to get the data going.
No, I don't think so, because you'd have to do a lot of work in the planner and have the foreign data wrapper inject stuff in the planner saying you have to do this in a specific order in order to join to this. So it'd be kind of get really ugly and put a lot of onus on the foreign data wrapper of developers in order to do that when you're trying to do something non-relational inside of a relational construct, and it doesn't really make much sense to do it.
Okay, thank you.
This is, again, another one of those things that you could do it in Postgres. It's not necessarily a good idea to do it. It's cool that you could do it. I could geocode all this stuff, and it'll look like a table. That geocoder API looks like a table, and I could run queries on it, SQL on it, instead of doing a HTTP post in order to get the data.
Yeah.
But in reality, it's not a table.
Right.
It just looks like one.
Right.
I mean, operationally in production, I would do this. I would get my data, pull my data, and do the geocoding later.
Yep.
Because you never know when you're going to have a timeout or something.
Right.
The problem with that strategy is that your data is changing underneath. The how often are you going to be uploading? That's your problem.
I think if cities are moving that fast, we have other problems.
Okay.
Well, they are with this real-time analytics stuff that everyone wants to do, right? But they're not using Postgres. That's what they're using Cassandra for.
Well, and I've been doing a lot of GIS work, which is why I pay a lot of attention to it. That's all.
And really, the right thing to do is do all this in Postgres with the PostGIS query and pull in the OpenStreetMaps like data set, and you could all do it on your own local thing and not worry about it. But this is just one of those things where keep in mind with these foreign data wrappers is you're not necessarily using relational data sources.
Right.
So they behave like the source system, not like a Postgres table.
Right.
Right. So you have to understand how they're going to behave. So, like when you're dealing with Cassandra or Mongo, they're going to behave like Cassandra or Mongo, even though you put a Postgres front end on top of it.
Your comments are really valuable, thank you.
So writing a new one. There's a couple dozen of them out there. Andrew Dunstan wrote a pretty cool black hole one that you could use as a template in order to write new ones. It's basically filling in a bunch of C code, and really the top group are the ones that you need. Essentially what it is you're beginning a scan and iterating over. Run the query and iterate over the result set. It's basically what you need to do. If you want to make it writable, there's a lot more to do in there. They're not overly difficult to do, but you have to understand some Postgres internals in order to do it. I wrote a few of them. They're not that onerous, but they do take a little bit of work.
Is this similar?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's.
There's some crossover there.
Yeah, these are the foreign scan. So you're basically implementing the foreign scan.
Custom scan.
Well, custom scan is a little different. It's kind of building on this a little bit more. So that was part of the PG Strom thing that originally got that ball rolling on there. So you can implement some of this stuff with the custom scan API. But it's, 9.6 is going to be a lot clearer about how those two things work together. So, unless you're going to be using the foreign data wrappers for high frequency type things, a lot easier way to do it, multi-corner. It's writing foreign data wrappers in Python. The multi-corner API lets you be able to plug in whatever Python code you want in order to be able to do that. So anything you want to access. So this gentleman over here at the New York conference last year, he wrote a foreign data wrapper to interface with the Hue Philips Philips light bulbs. So this way you can turn them on and off and change the colors by updating tables. Right? It was just kind of fun being able to do that. Right, so you can, and he wrote it all in Python in order to be able to do that and change the colors from green to red and turn them on and off and did interesting, fun things with it. Pretty much anything you could access with Python, you could go ahead and write a foreign data wrapper through Multicorn and be able to access that. So while you could do it with the Internet of Things and be able to turn on your devices, you could do that with you could update a thing on a table and change a thermostat. Right, change your Nest thermostat if they have, I think they have an API where you can go ahead and change that. If you want to do some fun things, you can do that through Postgres. Right, so it makes it a lot simpler. Right, so this is the iCal foreign data wrapper with Multicorn, and that's the whole thing. Right, very simple, not a lot to do if you want. It's a readable iCal thing, so this way you can be able to see it inside of your database of what your calendar looks like. The future, more and more foreign data wrappers all the time. Every time I look up, there's somebody wrote another one, right, which is saying a lot because it really makes Postgres being kind of the center of the universe there as you're being able to access all these different data sources. It makes it so this way you can experiment with those new NoSQL databases, play a little bit, but you still could access it through Postgres. Right? So that's especially true is a lot of these NoSQL databases don't have any security. So if you want to be able to let your users access some of the things, let's say Mongo or Cassandra, you could leverage Postgres security and grant privileges on specific tables and not let them touch that backend data. So this way you can experiment a little bit there and be secure. So there are more and more. So the next flavor of the month in a NoSQL database, sure there's going to be a foreign data wrapper for it. In 9.5, a couple of these things are in 9.5, so they're not officially out yet, but they're almost there. Check constraints on foreign tables. So this way, if you want to use a foreign table as part of your partitioning scheme, so maybe you want to archive off some of your old data, last year's data, onto another server, you could do that and still be able to query it. Import foreign schema. That is, when you import, when you have more than one, that makes it a huge difference. So not having to type all those create table statements. You can import the whole foreign schema in there, make it nice and simple. So the joins are kind of there with the custom scan API. If some of the foreign data wrapper developers want to go ahead and implement that, you can push down joins. I tried it as a proof of concept with the Hadoop one. It works. I'm not releasing that yet because I think the API is going to change for 9.6, so I don't want to do the same thing twice unless we need it for a specific customer or something. But and there's going to be more and more features because this is, for those of you that listen to some of Bruce's talks and other things, it's foreign data wrappers kind of look like the way to go to the future of horizontally scaling Postgres. Right? That's at least one of the ways that we're thinking about doing it, of being able to push down remote queries, parallelize it across things. You could get a real basic MPP system with parallelization and foreign data wrappers to do that. It's not a Green Plum or Citus thing just yet, but you can get some basic stuff there. And also, depending on what your needs are, you could do more of the foreign writes as well, so you don't need an XC or XL. Could be a big thing in the future, and it's kind of just a fun topic to do. But any questions?
Since you just mentioned Bruce, he gave two talks here very recently, and he mentioned foreign data wrappers. And when we're talking about futures, I'm hopeful that you can add a little to what he was talking about, because he seemed to put forward the idea that foreign data wrappers are actually, aside from their utility to access foreign data, mm-hmm. are really critical to the next major steps in Postgres development.
Yeah, it depends on which way the community goes with doing distributed Postgres instead of just being on a single server. It is a mechanism that's already there in order to be able to access other Postgres databases. And when you want to do sharding, right? It's a quick way of doing sharding. Whether or not that's going to be the ultimate way it's done, it looks likely. But there's been a lot of talk on the hackers list about the right way of doing that, and some you have some dissenting opinions. But I think it's ultimately going to end up using the foreign data wrapper API and just making it more robust. It's there already. Why reinvent the wheel?
Thank you. So you're from the East Coast area. I've heard that a lot of the financial companies in Manhattan are using mm-hmm. Postgres a lot more and getting yeah. a lot more interested in it. But it sounds like with this Hadoop work you've done, you're also kind of doing something that the web companies back there would be interested in. So what can you say about the New York area is in terms of Postgres increasing in use? Is it banks that are doing it? Is it the web people, both? What's going on?
All the above.
Yeah.
The big banks are certainly using Postgres. So at the New York conference 2 years ago, the keynotes were Goldman Sachs and Morgan Stanley about saying how much they love Postgres. Legally, they couldn't say what they were using it for, but they're using it more and more. But also, New York has a huge startup scene. And what we're finding now is people, when they're starting a new project, they're just putting it on Postgres. Whereas years ago, they would start in MySQL. Now they're just starting in Postgres, at least in New York and Philadelphia.
Yeah, actually, there was an article on Tech Republic a few months ago that it is the number one database for startup. That Postgres is the number one database for startups. nationally, not just, I don't know about internationally, but nationally, not at all just East Coast.
You know what seems interesting about these financial companies in New York and Manhattan, lower Manhattan, using Postgres, seems like that could be a good source of sponsorship for the core developers, because these banks, even though they don't want to help their competitors, it's chump change for them. And if they get something material in return for it, it seems like they're maybe moving away from Oracle or something, might be a good source to tap into for.
It'd be nice, but they're tied, hands are tied by their lawyers.
Oh.
Yeah,
oh.
That sounds, yeah, this would be, this would definitely be a pub topic.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Are you going to throw it out? We are getting close to that time.
All right.
I have a lot of details about that specific topic, about at least around the banks.
I'll be right back.
Any other questions? Well, thanks, everybody.
Thanks, Jim.